Hello everyone, welcome back to English English with Kashish. Yes, are you ready for our next chapter? Today I'm going to teach you The Gift of Magi, written by O. Henry. It's a very, very beautiful chapter. It's about togetherness. It's about how in life you have ups and downs, still the love for each other never goes away. Yes. Now, little about the author. Now, let's learn a little bit about our author, O. Henry. He was an American short story writer whose tales romanticized the commonplace. That means he used to write short stories which we could relate to in our everyday lives. In particular, the life of ordinary people in New York City. Because he was from New York. His stories expressed the effect of coincidence on character through humor, grim or irony. Yes, and often had surprise endings. A device that became identified with his name and cost him critical favor when its vogue had passed. Now, he used to use these few expressions like humor, that is laughter, grim, that is sadness, ironic, that means something that we do not expect to happen. Okay, The Gift of Magi, our short story, is a beautiful story of a young couple, yes, who have no money. They have no money, yet wish to buy each other Christmas gifts. They want to buy each other gifts even though they are going through a hard time. This is the story of Jim and Della. They are a cute little couple and how they spend their life during Christmas. Now let's move on to our chapter. Yes, can you start reading with me? $1.87. That was all. And 60 cents of it was in pennies, coins. Pennies saved one and two at a time by bulldozing the grocer and the vegetable man and the butcher until one's cheeks burned with the silent imputation of parsimony that such close dealing implied. Now, what does this statement mean? Now, Della was saving little money. Yes, I will tell you for what she was saving the money later. Yeah, but she was saving money how? By bargaining, by bulldozing the grocer. She was fighting with everyone and bargaining with everyone. The grocer, the vegetable vendor and the butcher. Who is the butcher? The meat seller. She used to go to them and bargain for every little money. But do you think she was happy about that? Secretly, she was not. Her cheeks would turn red when she would do that. She was feeling very, very bad about it. But she was saving money. Three times Della counted it. She counted it three times just to be sure of it. $1.87 it was. Yes. And the next day was Christmas. Christmas is the time when they buy gifts for each other. I would like to tell you a short story about the name of our story, The Gift of the Magi. Who were Magi? Magi were those three wise men who came down during Christmas when Jesus was born and they got so many gifts for him. That's when the trend of exchanging gifts on Christmas started. That's what they do. They exchange gifts. So it was Christmas coming by. There was clearly nothing to do but flop down on the shabby little couch and howl. She jumped. She sat on the couch and she started crying. And she started howling. Della did that, which instigates the moral reflection that life is made up of sobs, crying, sniffles. When you cry like this, it's called sniffle, and smiles, with sniffles predominantly. Why were sniffles predominant here? Why were sniffles more here? Because they were going through a very bad financial time. They were in difficult times, so they were more of cries. But still, she would make sure that she is happy when her husband comes back. While the mistress of the home is gradually subsiding from the first stage to the second, take a look at the home. Although she was trying her best to keep herself happy, she would feel sad sometimes. They were in first stage, now they were coming to the second stage. Yes. A furnished flat at $8 per week. They were paying a rent of $8 per week. It did not exactly give beggar description. They had not come down to a position of a beggar. But it certainly had that word on the lookout for the mendicancy squad. Who are these people? They are these people who come and give shelter to homeless people and beggars. But they had not come to that situation still. Next, in the vestibule below was a letterbox into which no letter would go. Right? They had a little letterbox in which the letter would not even go in. And an electric button from which no mortal finger could coax a ring. That what is coax a ring? That means you can't get into it. And even if you got into it, you might get a shock. Also, appertaining thereunto was a card bearing the name Mr. James Dillingham Young. Into that, going into that was a card which said his name, James Dillingham Young. His name was written on the door just above the doorbell. The Dillingham had been flung to the breeze during a former period of prosperity when its possessor was being paid $30 per week. Now earlier he was called Dillingham. Now it had come down. Although his respect had not come down a lot, but yes, little it had come down. Earlier he used to get $30 per week. Now when the income was shrunk to $20, though they were thinking seriously of contracting to a modest and unassuming D. Now he had come back to D. Now they had become from Dillingham to D. Yes. Moving on, whenever Mr. James Dillingham came home and reached his flat above, he was called Jim. Yes, he was called Jim because Della loved him, and this was the name she used to call him, and greatly hugged by Mrs. James Dillingham. Although they were going through a very tough patch, they loved each other, and this is how she expressed her love towards him, by hugging him when he came back from work. Already introduced to you as Della. Who was Della? Dillingham Young. Mrs. Dillingham Young, his wife, was called Della. Which is all very good. This all is very good. Della finished her cry and attended to her cheeks with a powder 33 rag. Just before her husband would come, she would cry, cry, cry. And then she would put lots of powder on her face and become happy to show him that she was not sad. She stood by the window and looked out dully at a grey cat walking a grey fence in a grey backyard. Everything was grey for her because her life was dull. Tomorrow would be Christmas Day. Tomorrow is Christmas. And she had only $1.87 with which to buy Jim a present. She had been saving every penny she could for months and months and months. With this result, she was not happy with the result. What can you buy with such little money? $20 a week doesn't go far. Her expenses were a lot. $20 a week was not sufficient. Expenses had been greater than she had calculated. They always are, right? Or expenses are so much. Only $1.87 to buy a present for Jim. Her own Jim, whom she loved so much. Many a happy hours she had spent planning for something nice for him, something fine and rare and sterling, something very precious, something just a little bit near to being worthy of the honor of being owned by him. She was his. She was owned by Jim. So what could she give him that was precious, that was nice? You can't buy such a present with $1.87, right? Yes. Let's see what she does next. There was a pier glass between the windows of the room. Perhaps you have seen a pier glass in an $8 flat. The mirror in her room did not give her a perfect picture of herself. It was a little crooked, like a concave. A very thin and very agile person may, by observing his reflection in a rapid sequence of longitudinal strips. What are longitudinal strips? They are like those long strips like this, which give a very bad picture of you. Obtain a fairly accurate conception of his looks. It's fairly accurate. It is not perfectly accurate, but little bit accurate. Now, Della, being slender, had mastered the art. She has mastered the art of angling herself in such a way that she could see herself perfectly. Yes. Now let's see, why is Della looking into the mirror? What is she planning to do? Suddenly, she whirled from the window and stood before the glass. She was sitting by the window and suddenly she moved to the glass. Her eyes were shining brilliantly, but her face had lost its color within 20 seconds. She was happy and then she was sad again. Rapidly, she pulled down her hair. She opened her hair and let it down full to its full length. She opened her hair and she wanted to see how long they are and how beautiful they are. She was very, very fond of her hair. Now, there are two possessions of the James Dillingham Young, in which they both took a mighty pride. Now, this couple had two things they were very proud of. They were their precious little things which they could never get apart from. What are these two special things? One was Jim's gold watch that had been his father's and his grandfather's. So, his grandfather gave a watch to his father. And his father gave that watch to him. That was a watch which is round and it had a chain on it. That was the precious belonging that he had. The other was Della's hair. She loved her hair. And Jim also loved Della's hair. Had the Queen of Sheba lived in the flat across the air shaft, Della would have let her hair hang out of the window same day to dry just to depreciate her. She says that the Queen of Sheba, which was very, very popular for her hair, beautiful hair, if she lived right across her, she would get jealous of Della's hair. Majesty's jewels and gifts. Had King Solomon been the janitor with all his treasures piled up in the basement, Jim would have pulled out his watch every time he passed, just to see him pluck at his beard from envy. They say that their possessions would make anyone jealous. Yes. So what do they do with their possessions? So now, Della's beautiful hair fell about, dripping and shining like a cascade of brown water. Like brown water falls down as a waterfall, Della's hair fell down like that. It reached below her knee and made itself almost a garment for her. They were so thick and they were so long that they reached below their knee. And then she did it up again nervously. She suddenly got nervous, pulled it up and tied it again. And quickly, and once she faltered for a minute and stood still while a tear or two splashed on the worn red carpet. A tear or two fell down on the red carpet. Now, Della was sad. She was feeling sad. She opened her hair. She was happy. Suddenly, quickly, she tied it back and she was sad. What was she thinking? We will find out that in part 2. End of part 1. Now, ready to solve some questions? Come on, let's do it. Question number 1, which is on page number 40. How did Della save her $1.87? What all she did? Della had saved the money by bargaining hard about prices with the grocer, the vegetable man, and the butcher, the meat man. Question number 2. The writer gives details of Jim's flat. Pick out the details. It was a furnished flat for $8 per week. That was the rent that they paid. There was nothing to describe actually. In the vestibule below was a letterbox into which no letter would go, and an electric button from which no mortal finger could coax a ring. Attached to the button was a card bearing the name Mr. James Dillingham Young. Now you remember, we talked about what rent they paid, the letterbox, the electric button, and the name. You remember these points and describe. Question 3. The card bearing the full name of Jim now had only one letter D on it. State whether the statement is true or false. It's true. Yes, his full name had come down to letter D. Question 4. What were the most precious possessions of Jim and Della? The most precious possessions of Jim was the gold watch that had been his father's and his grandfather's before him. Della's possession was her long, rippling, shining hair that fell down like a cascade of brown waters. Question 5. How was the writer compared Della's hair to Queen of Sheba's jewels? Why did writer compare Della's hair to Sheba's jewels? The writer says that had the Queen of Sheba lived in the flat across the air shaft, Della would have let her hair hang out the window someday to dry, just to depreciate that Majesty's jewels and gifts. All the Majesty's jewels and gifts were nothing compared to Della's hair. Question 6. How was the writer compared Jim's watch to King Solomon's treasures? Now the writer has compared both the possessions to something more valuable to that. The writer says that had King Solomon been the janitor with all his treasures piled up in the basement, Jim would have pulled out his watch every time he passed just to see him pluck at his beard with envy. He would just look at him like that and say, "Ha ha, see my watch, much more precious than all your jewels." Question 7. Why did Della decide to sell her hair? Della decided to sell her hair because she wanted to buy a gift for Jim, and she had only $1.87, which was not sufficient to buy any gift. Hence, she decided to sell her hair and buy a good gift with the money she would get. And now we are at the end of the part 1. We have attempted all the questions also. Lots of games and quizzes for you on the app. I shall see you back for the part 2.